Welcome to the Heart of a Viking. These art lessons are taught by Mrs. Minto from the Cape Henlopen School District in Delaware. I hope you have fun, create imaginative works of art, and make sure you share them with someone because, after all, the visual arts are meant to be seen.
Hello, Cape artists, and welcome back to the Heart of a Viking. In the videos this week, we're learning a whole lot about the continent of Antarctica and how scientists use experiments and the International Ice Patrol uses tracking radars to study what icebergs are made out of and where they float when they're out in the ocean. Well, I don't know about you, but I found learning about icebergs extremely interesting. My three favorite facts from this week are that most of the iceberg is actually below the surface of the water, so what you see on top is only a small portion of what there really is. Icebergs are made of fresh water because they're made from snow. And while they're out in the ocean melting away, they create a nutrient-rich environment around them, and sea creatures and fish love that, so they often feed around the melting iceberg. So for our scientific art project for today, we're going to be creating our own scientific experiment that in turn creates a beautiful icy effect on our piece of artwork. So let's learn a little bit more about those icebergs and then start our own scientific art project.
What is an iceberg, you asked? Well, icebergs are pieces of ice that formed on land and then float into an ocean or a lake. Icebergs come in all shapes and sizes, from ice cube-sized chunks to ice islands the size of a small country. The term iceberg refers to a chunk of ice larger than 15 feet across. Smaller bergs might be known as bergy bits or growlers and can be especially dangerous for ships because they're harder to spot. The North Atlantic and the cold waters surrounding Antarctica are home to most of the icebergs on Earth. Icebergs form when chunks of ice calve or break off from glaciers, ice shelves, or larger icebergs. Icebergs can travel with the ocean currents, sometimes smashing up against the shore or getting caught in shallow waters. When an iceberg reaches warm water, the new climate attacks it from all sides. The warmer air and warmer water temperatures begin to melt the iceberg from all sides. Icebergs pose a danger to ships that are traveling in the North Atlantic and the waters around Antarctica. After the Titanic sank in 1912, the United States and 12 other countries formed the International Ice Patrol that warns ships of icebergs in the North Atlantic. The Iceberg Patrol uses airplanes and radars to track icebergs that float into major shipping lanes. The U.S. National Ice Center uses satellite data to monitor icebergs near Antarctica. Even though they pose a danger to ships, icebergs can also serve as a tool for scientists who study them to learn more about climate and ocean processes. Climate scientists study icebergs as they break up for clues to the process that caused the ice shelf to collapse. By studying the factors that cause icebergs to break up, researchers hope to better understand the influences that lead to ice shelf breakups and to better predict how ice shelves will respond to a warming climate. Oceanographers follow icebergs because the cold fresh water that the icebergs contribute to the sea can influence currents and ocean circulation far away from their origins. And biologists study icebergs to find out how they influence ocean life. As icebergs melt, they leak nutrients into the ocean around them. Recent studies have shown that the water surrounding icebergs teems with plankton, fish, and other sea life. Who knew icebergs could be so interesting and beautiful? Let's see if what we've learned helps us to create the most amazing iceberg seascapes. Alrighty, so for our iceberg seascape, we'll need a white piece of paper and either a blue or a black. It just depends on what time of day you want it to be in your picture. Blue for daytime, black for nighttime. We'll need a glue stick, some scissors. We'll need a white, a blue, and a purple crayon. We'll need some washable markers in brown, purple, black, and blue. And a pencil, a paintbrush, and some water. And salt, you know, like from your kitchen that you would put on your food, and a piece of newspaper. All right, so on our white piece of paper, we're going to start with drawing some straight lined geometric shapes. So any kinds of triangles, rectangles, squares, anything that looks like that, even fancy hexagons, anything that has a straight line, not circles and ovals. And we're going to do this with our black marker, and we're going to make it fill the entire page. So as many as you want. You can draw your small, mine are kind of on the big side. You could draw your smaller or larger than me, or try and make them kind of the same, but you're filling the whole paper with your black washable marker and you're making straight lined geometric shapes. Now I'm going to grab one of my other colors of marker. I picked blue first, and I'm just going to add a little bit of blue on some of the lines. Now I'll switch to purple and do the same thing. I can even put the purple right near some of the blue lines. Now some brown. Okay, so now I'm going to grab my white crayon, and I'm going to, kind of in a scribbly sort of way, I'm going to make some white crayon marks inside of those geometric shapes I made with my markers. I want to try to not get the crayon on the marker. I just want to color in the spaces that are still white. Press kind of hard, and you want to press hard enough to where you definitely know that you're pressing hard and you're not being too gentle. The harder you press, the better effect we'll get in a little while. Oh, I pressed a little too hard. I broke my crayon. That's okay. Now I have two. And I want to try and get some white in each of the spaces. So I do that in two ways. If you see, I'm kind of like feeling with my left hand. I can feel where I put the white crayon. I also sort of tip it around and let the shadows dance across my page. The shadows help reveal where I might have missed too. All right, so now that part is done, I'm going to grab my water, make sure I'm on my newspaper and my paintbrush, and I'm just simply wetting the entire piece of paper. You might remember that when you wet marker like this, the marker is going to run a little bit. It's going to smear and spread across the page, and where the colors are close together, it's going to create some additional fun colors too. Now I'm just adding a bit more water because today's project, I want this to be kind of wet, sort of puddly. Now I'm going to take that salt that I got out of my kitchen and sprinkle it all over my piece of artwork. Okay, and now I'm going to stop. All right, so we need this to dry before we can move on. A couple of options are, one is just let it dry, simply let it sit on the table, walk away, go do something else, check back later, see if it's dry. Option two is you can set it out in the sun if it's a sunny day. The sun will definitely help it dry a whole lot faster. But this time, drying with a hairdryer is not going to be an option. Since we sprinkled the salt onto our picture, we want the salt to dry exactly where it is, and the air from the hairdryer would blow it away. So this time we are not going to use a hairdryer. We're either going to just be patient and wait or put it out in the sun. Alrighty, so let's work on the background while we're waiting for that to dry. Go ahead and grab your blue or black paper that you're going to be working on, and your white, your purple, and your blue crayon, and your pencil. Let's start by using the pencil to draw the horizon line. The horizon line in this picture is going to separate the sea from the sky. And we'll use our white crayon next, and the white crayon is going to be water waves. The first waves I make are close to the horizon line, and they're just kind of like wiggly lines. As I get closer to the bottom, the waves get larger. That's because that's how it appears in the ocean. Now I'm going to use my white crayon a little more gently and just sort of scribble a little bit some reflections in the water. And my reflections start on the waves and kind of work their way down. Again, no right or wrong way to do this, adding some white. Now, starting at the horizon line, I'm going to add some extra white that's very light. I'm very gently pressing this across. My goal this time is to make the water appear a little lighter than the sky. Now I'm going to grab the blue and just add some blue right beside the white. This will add some contrast. This contrast is going to be very valuable later in making the waves appear as if they are 3D and actually rising up off the surface of the sea. And I'll repeat the same thing with my purple. A little purple next to that blue and that white too. So now we're going to switch over to the sky. Using our white crayon, we're going to make little white dots. These will be the stars in the night sky. I like to make mine several different sizes. The ones I'm making right now are kind of large. Now I'm going to press a little lighter more quickly and make some smaller ones. And the stars can be all the way down to the horizon line. You don't have to keep them all the way at the top. Stars would be all the way down, especially in Antarctica. When there isn't any light pollution that's lighting up the sky, you would be able to see the stars far more clearly and see way more of them than you do around here. Now I'm going to add a moon. I'm making a crescent moon. You can make a different kind of moon if you like, a half moon or a full moon. Alright, as soon as your iceberg art is all dry, you're going to bring it back to your art table and really investigate it. This looks so cool. Each place where there's a tiny little dot, that's where the salt sort of sucked up the ink that was there from when we painted. It ends up looking crystally and cold, perfect for icebergs. All right, so flipping that piece of artwork over, we're going to draw our iceberg shapes. Iceberg shapes are gonna be kind of triangular, so I'm going up and coming back down as if I was drawing a triangle. And I'm gonna keep the edges a little bit bumpy and wavy. These are ice forms that are floating in the ocean, so they should not be any kind of perfect lines, just wiggly, a little wobbly. I'm making this one sort of round at the top. Definitely wider at the bottom, smaller at the top. Perfect. And I'm gonna let it sit there. Don't glue it down yet. Alright, and then going back to your painting again, you're going to make as many icebergs as you would like. You can make 2, 3, 4, 17, whatever number you like. And just keep laying them on, moving them around as you want, so that we have an opportunity to adjust them if we need to. This time, I'm going to play with overlapping. Overlapping means that one iceberg is going to be behind the other one. I felt like the one that was behind was a little too large, so I trimmed a little off the bottom, and now it's perfect. Okay, I think I'm gonna go with 3. So now before I glue these down, I'm gonna work with whichever one is furthest away first. That's the one right here that I'm touching. And I'm going to grab my white crayon again, and I'm going to show either the shadow or reflection of the iceberg in the water, or maybe my water is clear enough and I can actually see the bottom part of the iceberg under the water. Because remember, only part of the iceberg is floating above the water. A lot of it's under the water. And when you're done with that, go ahead and grab your glue stick, apply some glue, make sure you get it on the edges there and a little bit in the center, place it back right where it was, turn it over, and rub from the back. All right, so we're just gonna keep repeating those steps. Hold the next iceberg into place. Use your white crayon to make the reflection or the iceberg that's under the water and visible from the surface. Go ahead and put some glue on the back, press it on, flip it over, press it down, and keep repeating until all of your icebergs are glued on. Well, we did it again, scientific artists. We had our own science experiment happening right there on our watercolors today. The salt, the way it reacts with the water panes is really incredible. Now, before you head out, don't forget to hit subscribe on the Heart of a Viking channel so that I know that you were here, and click like so that I know that you finished the project. I hope you had a great time, learned something new, and I'll see you back here next time at the Heart of a Viking. HOB artists, don't forget to hop on over to Art Sonia, to upload a photograph of your piece of artwork to your art portfolio. I can't wait to see it.